Hi everyone, this is Duncan from the podcast Under the Stairs. This particular video you're checking out just now has the archival recording attached to it. The archival recording is from our podography, I think that's the term that we use, and it will feature reviews of movies that fall under the 88 Films Italian Collection series. Now, the vast majority of reviews we've done over the last 5 years have been in audio format and published on our RSS feed for the podcast. We are transitioning over to give you access to all those reviews right here on YouTube under a playlist. Now, we're doing that because we're about to do our first video recording of the 88 Films Italian Collection release, that being Tentacles. So there's plenty of opportunity to delve into the back catalogue of the reviews here. And if you like what you hear, then please hit subscribe on the channel, leave your comments below, and check out the rich catalogue of over 1,200 episodes we have on podcasts Under the Stairs on any podcatching device or Spotify that you use. So stick around, enjoy the episode, and I'll speak to you very soon.
And the one and only Marazzi Vincenzo, better known as the Hunchback of Rome. You've heard of me, eh? Yeah. Vai? Gigi? Come on, let's have everyone cough up. Wallets, rings, clean them out. Yeah, the dude there was right. We're the scum of the earth.
We're a bunch of losers, right? Only all you winners need losers to make us look good. A pile of cruds around in a jewel.
Marazzi, Sergio, also known as Pigsty, the Hunchback's twin brother. Let's start by keeping an eye on the pig. Heard anything recently from your brother Humpo?
Inspector, my brother don't like to be called that by a cop. So, okay, his back is a bit twisted, but you and I together will never be half the guy he is. There's a bunch of dough in the neighborhood of, 800 million, just begging to be took. You interested?
Yeah, we're interested.
Okay. We work with these.
In all that confusion, one of you accidentally happens to blow a hole in his hump.
The loot gets split only three ways.
I should have known I couldn't trust you to finish it. Now we have cops and the Hunchback to worry about.
Hey, you'll get the Chump of the Year award. You don't get all three of them.
By the look of it, sir, I would say it was somebody who had a score to settle.
Tell him that if the cops get him, he should take and swallow a couple of cigarettes.
We do it without filter.
Look, what he told me to tell you, I told you.
Yeah, but what I want to know is what happens to me when I swallow the cigarettes.
Hiya, Jesus. Oh, why, you could have stepped out of a church window. Just like on those little cards. Listen, Jesus, there's a flock of guys getting rich off you on Earth. You're one of the wellest known guys down there. I mean, you're bigger than King Kong.
Fincher, what are you...
I'm gonna have to operate.
No.
And I can't give you nothing for the pain.
No.
I'm putting it to you, Inspector. I want to be rid of that damn Hunchback once and for all.
He ain't gonna let up till I've signed in on the tombstone. That'll be the day. That'll be the day he does that to you. Am I wrong?
So, you've just heard the trailer for Brothers Till We Die. This is disc number 57 in the old 88 Films Italian Collection series. This is directed by the late, great Umberto Lenzi from 1978, just before he heads up a little cannibal double bill with such great titles as Eaten Alive and Cannibal Ferox. This is that kind of weird territory that seemed to kind of spring up kind of post the giallo, where we just started getting lots of crime movies, and that was where the cinema in Italy was really kind of, you know, delving into. Let's find out what it says on the 88 Films website, and then we'll get into my thoughts and musings on this baffling movie. It says, even before he became king of the cannibal movie, Umberto Lenzi of Cannibal Ferox and Eaten Alive fame specialised in another sort of savagery. Brothers Till We Die is a hard-as-nails crime flick with the very great Thomas Milan of Syndicate Sadist and Django Kill doing double duty as lookalike brothers, Il Gobbo the Hunchback and Ermoneza, both of them up to no good. A robbery is planned, but the boys are betrayed. You better believe that revenge is on the way, served up as only Lenzi can. A follow-up to Lenzi's earlier Rome, Armed to the Teeth, Brothers Till We Die is one of the best of the police-style, can't pronounce that word, cycle. The tough Italian action movies that gave Clint Eastwood a run for his money in the 70s. 88 Films are proud to present the Blu-ray premiere of this ruthless classic. Special features, depending on when you bought it, you would have got a limited edition slipcase and limited edition notes by Italian cinema expert Francesco Massianzi. An HD transfer in the original 235 one aspect ratio, remastered uncompressed English audio, remastered uncompressed Italian audio with newly translated subtitles, an audio commentary by genre expert and friend of the podcast Under the Stairs, Troy Holworth, and webmaster of Mondo Digital, Nathaniel Thompson, Heart of Rome, an interview with the composer Antonello Venditti, Master of Funk, an interview with composer Franco Michalesi, an introduction by Mike Malloy, director of Eurocrime, a reversible sleeve with alternate Italian poster. The technical specs is this is region unlocked, so you can watch this anywhere you want. Audio is LPCM dual mono, pictures HD 1080p 235.1. The runtime is 1 hour 38 minutes approx. The languages are both English and Italian with English subtitles. So this is a head scratcher, to say the least. This movie is fucking hella entertaining, like absolutely, like bafflingly entertaining, but it suffers some huge central problems. The biggest central problem is obviously the dubious wigs here, like to the point where my eyes could not take in anything that was happening out with the fact that Thomas Milan is playing two brothers here, who are wearing horrendous fucking £1 wigs, one of them being an almost kind of longer haired equivalent of Liza Minnelli, and the other one being what I can only imagine is a kind of 70s, you know, Liverpudlian footballer scouser perm. Yeah, just like horrendous wigs. The story itself is about, you know, this kind of miscreant brother who is kind of trying to toe the good life. Once again, there's so much grey area with these characters, it's difficult to even know whether or not you should support their criminal activities. But he works in a garage, he's a good mechanic, but you know, he's scraping for ends meet. And then his brother returns from making a fairly successful outing up in France and making quite a bit of money doing, you know, criminal activity. Also played by Thomas Milan. This particular criminal is nicknamed the Hunchback because he's a hunchback. And Milan totally plays into that, maybe two steps of short of, you know, going, the bell. And he shows up and he comes back with a wad of money and this plan to make a great score. Tries to partner up with some local criminals who, for whatever reason, and the movie never really goes out its way to explain the logic behind this, attempt to assassinate him. I'm assuming it's so they can take all the money, but it seems short-sighted considering they're going to, you know, at the most they're going to make a quarter of what this man is going to bring in on top of what they've already made. So it seems a bit short-sighted. And of course their hit on him
goes awry, misses, and the Hunchback makes a play for revenge, slowly building a criminal underworld. Take into account this movie's an hour and a half, so a lot happens. Building up a criminal underworld and then basically making a play and exacting revenge by systematically picking off each of the people that tried to set him up before becoming like a crime lord that the police ultimately try and take down. In the background, his brother's helping where he can, but his brother gets locked up for going crazy and, you know, the police put an informant in with him. And then ultimately at the end, and I'm jumping a lot of details here, but trust me, there are baffling things going on here. Ultimately, at the end, the brother maybe fakes his own death and then gives his brother money and writes him a note saying, you know, I always loved you, even though I treated you like shit in real life. I always loved you, and go and do something good with this money because we all know that you're the one that can do good and whatnot. And the insinuation is maybe because he's managed to get out of a couple of near-death experiences, maybe he's going to live. I don't know. The Hunchback might still be around. Maybe. I don't know. Yeah, it's been a while since I've been kind of dumbfounded watching one of these movies. And this is a great example of a genre that I'm slowly becoming quite interested in with a lot of the Italian stuff, whether it be the spaghetti westerns, which I never used to really enjoy, but recently, through some of the titles in the 88 Films collection, I've found that I do have quite a bit of appreciation for the work that goes into it. And then the police procedural stuff as well. I've found quite a few titles, not necessarily all from 88 Films, some that Arrow have put out as well, that I genuinely think are great. And you come to a movie like this, and from the start, the tone is all over the place. You know, there's some stuff put in here for goofs and gags that don't quite work. And then there's some stuff that's put in here for kind of, look how sadistic this character is, that also doesn't really work either. Thomas Milan is, yeah, he's doing double duty and he's doing well for what he's doing, but he's stuck with the two conceits of one character being an utter buffoon and the other one having a hunch, which makes it kind of difficult to take that character seriously, even though he's pained and wounded, and at times you do feel sympathetic that he can't do the most basic of rudimentary things, yet he's kind of overcompensating. This is like angry small man syndrome. He's kind of overcompensating and flexing his muscles, but he's not a nice character at all, and we spend a huge chunk of this movie with him, watching him mistreat women, watching him, you know, build up a criminal enterprise and kill off people. Now, yes, he's killing off criminals, but he himself is a criminal, so it's difficult to work out whether or not he's an antagonist or a protagonist. And because his brother, his haphazard brother, is kind of assisting him and helping him out without any real moral compass either, you're really rooting for the villains in this movie against other villains. And where that maybe works in a movie like The Long Good Friday, for example, it doesn't necessarily work all that well here. It's shot brilliantly. I mean, whatever you want to say about Umberto Lenzi, even on his off days, the man behind the camera is fucking great. Yeah, the storytelling's ropey. I can't imagine he was wholly invested in the subject matter here, but it's really well shot. Really, really, really well shot. A bit leery at times, like a woman stands up and the camera starts off at the crotch, moves up to the tits before pulling back to show the face. And that is a Lenzi classic, ladies and gents. But the action shots are really vibrant, quick-paced, and that's Lenzi. Like, he's really, really, really good at doing that sort of stuff. The score in the movie is funky, it's quirky, it fits the time for sure. But ultimately, my biggest issue with the movie overall is I'm not entirely sure who we should be rooting for here. The best police procedural stuff is the ones where you're 100% behind the cops or you're 100% behind the villains. And I'm neither in this movie. Plus, the cops look like they're working in, like, the fucking NASA station at Houston, ground control. Is there some weird and funky computers in there and they're wearing lab coats to answer phones and shit like that? So you know for a fact this is straight off the set of some sci-fi movie that Lenzi's either involved with or someone else has loaned them the set for the day. And they've just used the same actors kind of toupeeing over it in this project. It just doesn't make sense and it doesn't add up, but adds to the quirk and charm. I mean, it's really difficult to say that I think this is a great movie. I don't, if I'm honest. Of the movies that we've seen in the kind of police procedural stuff, it's nowhere near the best of them at all. It's also nowhere near the worst, and for entertainment value, there is a whole lot of bang for your buck in this movie, for sure. It doesn't necessarily hold back at all, and it does give you some moments that are really quirky and really fun and definitely worth your time. I think overall, though, as a movie, though, it's a bit tonally dissonant. It's difficult always to get purchased, and I do have issues with any movie that is a kind of police procedural sort of thing where I there's so much grey area that I don't know who I should be rooting for as well. I mean, at the end of this movie pans off with maybe the hunch is still alive, and you're sitting there going, well, do I really want him to be alive? Do I really want his brother grieving him? I don't know. It's a difficult one. I mean, ultimately, a lot of the pressure's taken off with how we grade things in this show. It's going on with a kind of feeling as opposed to technical grades and whatnot. And it sits somewhere between I liked it and I really liked it, so I'll give it a 3.5 out of 5. But it is an oddity for sure. And like I say, if you can get your head past those wigs, and I don't think you will, and the inclusion of things like a beret, which I'm assuming, like, Milan is purely wearing the beret to keep the wig on. It has to be. There's no other reason for him just donning a beret out with. He visited France for a while, because that's the thing. So 3.5 for Brothers Till We Die. It's worth saying that the special features are actually really, really good in this one, including the introduction by Mike Malloy. I turned it on and off. I will go back at some point and listen to the full commentary with Troy on it. I do like Troy's commentaries, but I caught, like, switching it on and off intermittently, I caught a bit of it, and it sounded like they were having a blast chatting about it. And the print is really good. It's a really, really nice print for this movie. They've done a lot of great work on the restoration. I would recommend you watch it in English with, Italian with English subtitles, and don't watch the English dub. The English dub, the dialogue is, for lack of a better word, fucking howfing. So yeah, avoid that.